Jeez. So I'm gonna
All
start.
right.
This is the recording for Second Sweet Home Bible study on Wednesday, April 7th, 2021. So Minister Mays, you have the floor. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all for joining with us on tonight. We're always humbled to have you on here with us. We don't take it for granted
Amen.
that you take the time out of your day to join with us. But at the end of the day, we make time for what's important to us, and God should be important to all of us. And so we should be looking to be more committed during this time, because it's going to take us all being committed together to get through this hurdle that we're in right now. It's going to take everybody doing what they say that they're going to do for us to get to where God is trying to take us. And so the word committed, when I looked at the word committed simply says the state or quality of being dedicated to a cause or an activity, a promise to be loyal to someone or something. Again, commitment, the state or quality of being dedicated to a cause, an activity, a promise to be loyal to someone or something. And I dare not to give you the definition of commitment without giving you the definition of accountability. That ties with that accountability, responsible for one's own action, the quality of state of being accountable. Because a lot of times we don't commit because we don't want to be accountable, because we know that if we commit to something, that it's going to cost some accountability somewhere down the line when we don't do what we say that we have committed ourselves to do. But being committed, God requires us to be committed to him first. We oftentimes commit to everything else first, and then whatever little time that we have left, we try to fit God in our schedule. And when God should be first, I will promise you, and I stand on it, that if you will put God first, everything else will fit in. He says in Matthew 6 and 33, he says, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and he will, all these things will be added unto you as well. But the problem is that we're trying to seek our own things first instead of seeking what God has for us first. We seek our own thing, and we find ourselves, if you're like me, we find ourselves short every time that we're trying to do this thing on our own, because God didn't say we couldn't do some things, or we couldn't do some things, but he also reminded us that in Exodus, that he says that I'm a jealous God, and we can't have no other God before him. Sometimes we're making gods, little gods, out of things and out of people. And we have committed ourselves so much to them that we don't have no time for God. But the problem is that we never really want to be fully committed, because we know it would cost us something. We want to talk the good talk. We want to be on a basketball court, as I like to say, but we really don't want to get in the game. We want to stand from the side and shout orders and do things, but we don't never want to put our hands in. Because commitment, true commitment, causes us some self-denial. Means that we can't do some things that we want to do when God has given us an assignment, or when God has told us that there's something else that we have to do, then we should be doing that first. And so, but we don't want to do that. So we don't want to commit to anything, or we want to commit when it's convenient. We have convenience commitment. It's only when it's convenient for us. It's only when we can get on the right platform. But we have to be committed. We have to cost self-denial. In Luke 9 and 23 and 24, he says, then he said to all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. Then in 24, he said, for whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever lose their life for me will save it. Are you willing to be truly committed, or are we looking to be a form of commitment in front of people? Because sometimes we commit ourselves to things in front of people to make ourselves look good.
Amen.
We don't have a desire to really finish the task. We have a desire to make ourselves look good in front of everybody. But then when it comes time to serve, we lack in that area. But there is no partial commitment because partial commitment is just like no commitment at all. You don't know if they're not truly committed. Because one of the problems that we have in the church today is because your word should be your bond, at least to your Amen. Fellow brothers and sisters, or if pastor asks you to do something, or he should be able to assure to be able to trust you enough that you're able, that he's able to know that he can go home and rest, knowing that the task will get done. It's nothing like having somebody assign a task and not knowing if the task will be fulfilled or not. Because at the end of the day, the task will have to be done. If you're assigned to do something and for whatever reason you can't do it, you have a responsibility to let somebody know. Amen. We all have responsibility here because everybody is somebody. And we all are here to work together. We all are, we all here to come together, to work together, to get this thing done, whatever it is that the task that we have for that time to get done. But the Bible does tells us in 1 Corinthians 12 and 25 through 27 says, so that there should be no division in the body, but that is parts should have equal, but every part should have equal concern for each other. 26 says, if one part suffer, every part suffer with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. And 27 says, now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. We all have a part to do. It's not, we can't no longer walk around talking about that's not my job, or that's not what I'm supposed to do. If it's something that we can do, then we should get it done. Let's just step up and get it done. It'll make it a lot better for everybody else. But I understand, because we only want to show up when we feel like showing up. But we have to go back to looking at our attitudes. Our attitudes is a lot to have to do with our commitment to God.
All right.
You have to have the right attitude, because the attitude really sets the tone. Because we will allow a negative comment to stop us from serving God. We would allow an evil attitude to take over to keep us from being committed. How are we going to let one thing somebody said that we didn't like stop us from truly serving God? The one that woke us up this morning, the one that allowed us to make our way, the one that allowed us to breathe this air. How are we going to let one little comment, one little negative thing stop us from being committed? Because that leads me to believe that I have to look at it and say, were you really committed anyway, or was it just an illusion that you were committed?
Amen. Right.
We must get to a place that no matter what's going on, that we will not let that separate us from serving God, from being committed to the call that we have. And I'm not talking about just in service. If you commit yourself to something, if it's in your community, if it's on your job, wherever you commit yourself at, you should fulfill the commitment if you can. If not, then let them know that you can't do the commitment, because at the end of the day, when they know that we are Christians, the people that we let down is going to hold that against God and against us. And say, oh, they're supposed to be a Christian, but look at them. Every time they talk about something, they're lying. They say they always say they're going to do this and do that, but they never do it. And so it's a reflection on all of us as Christians. And so we have to learn to do what we say we are going to do. But we have to have the right mindset in order to be committed. Any questions so far? There any questions? Are we no. Quiet tonight. So, all right, let me ask a question. Do we find ourselves committed, or do we find ourselves committed when it's convenient? And that's something that we have to answer within ourselves. Because some of us think that we are committed, and we only commit it when it's convenient for us.
Amen.
Minister, I think that's something that people they struggle with.
Right.
Because, you know, they'll say, I'll be here. They'll make a promise to do this, to do that. But, and then you'll hear things like, but this came up. But I need to do this now, or they just don't get around to it for various reasons. But commitment, if I'm committed to do something, I have that time set aside to do that task. I can't let anything get in the way of it, you know? So especially when it comes to things for God, but you know, that's something people struggle with, and, you know, for real, it is.
Right. Yeah, we could, and you know, the one of the things that really sometimes get under my skin, I mean, things happen. We understand that yes. Things happen, but when you have committed yourself to something, and then you walk around like it never bothered you. When I'm committed to something and I can't fulfill that task for whatever came up, I feel bad within myself because I know that I my desires was to commit that. Was to complete that task, and I couldn't do it. So there's no way I could walk around with a smile on my face knowing that I have let somebody down, because whatever that task was, that means somebody else had picked up the banner, wherever it was at, whether it be church, on your job, or wherever. Somebody else had picked up that banner to make sure that that task got done. So they had to make some adjustments, which, you know, we all have made those adjustments, but it doesn't make me feel good personally if I can't complete a task that I've been assigned to, or that I've opened my mouth and said that I'll make sure that this task happened, you know, and how, I don't know how for the life of me that somebody can walk around as though it doesn't never bother them, you know, or you can go to sleep at night and do folks any old kind of way and then go to sleep at night and rest peacefully. I have an issue with that.
Well, the reason, Minister Mays, or one of the reasons, is because they weren't actually committed to the task in the first place. Sometimes when people agree to do things, this is my experience. When people have agreed to do things that I've asked them to do, I've learned later it was an agreement out of getting me to stop asking them. It was an agreement that if I say this, he'll go away. But in their minds and in their hearts, they weren't committed to that task. And so when we're not committed, I think it's a natural inclination to find things that came up. I can't do it now because of this. But if I was actually committed to it, you know, like you said, if I commit to do something and whatever comes up that I can't do it, I'm going to let you know as early as possible. And I'm going to work with you to figure out how I can still get that thing done or make sure it still gets done. I'm not just going to leave you hanging for lack of a better way to say it. So I won't be able to sleep it right if I don't make it right. But right. But that's because I was dedicated to it when I said I'm committed to it. But some people aren't. You know, they haven't bridged that chasm, you know, in their hearts.
Amen.
And at the time they committed themselves, a lot of times they are sincere in their commitment, but they never weigh out the responsibility that goes along with doing it. You know, at that time when they didn't take the time to consider if something come up, like Minister Ambrose just said, and you said in your dialogue, when you get your word about anything, you should try to do everything within your power and not to go against your word. And we do recognize that emergencies do come up, but absolutely, even in emergency cases, it should leave you with a damper feeling that these people were relying on you. And God relies on us. I mean, he charges us for the things we say. He said it's better not to make a vow than to make a vow and to break it. And your word, as far as the Bible is concerned, is the only salvation that you show people when you as a disciple of Christ, because people take you according to the words you said. If somebody never keeps their word, then we're not gonna take the things they say as being truthful, you know. And a lot of people is also dependent upon where the setting is, who's the setting for, you know, is it a big crowd? Is it a popular saying? Am I going to get notoriety from it? And so we commit for different reasons, for different things. But I think the commitment that you are basing with tonight is the devotion to Christ and the cause of Christ, regardless to what it makes you look like. And one of the things I thank God for when I spoke about it a couple of weeks ago about Palm Sunday, when he mentioned that he sent two of his disciples to loose the coat. He did not name his disciples. He faithfully sent two of them, and their names wasn't important because what? They answered the call. They were committed to the call. And one of the things that we suffer with as believers now is notoriety. If I'm not mentioned, if I don't get the billboard, then I don't want to be a part of it. If I get the billing, if I get the recognition, if I'm shown forth to get the numbers, let me use Facebook status to get the numbers, then I'm eager about doing certain things. But God doesn't reward us based upon the solidification of what man sees in us, but he bases upon our faithfulness to his word and the commands and the things that he have charged us to do. And if God charges you to do something, then I advise all of us as believers to make it our responsibility to be committed to that cause and find a way, as Minister Armbrister said, to do what you have committed yourself to do. Yeah. Praise God.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen. He tells us in 1 Kings 8:61, he says, "And may your hearts be fully committed to the Lord, our God, to live by his decrees and obey his commands as at this time." Because at the end of the day, for our commitment, it's a personal choice. Nobody have forced you.
Right.
And so that's what always get me. You have not been forced. You know, Pastor told us that it's better not to make a vow than to make a vow and break it. Ecclesiastes 5:5. It's better for us not to make that vow. Weigh it out. Look at the things that you have going. If your life is that busy, then you have to weigh those things out. Right. But the problem is you signed up for it. But you have not done the. You still are held accountable for that task. When you have not showed up to do whatever it is that God, and you don't want the punishment of God on you because you didn't do what he told you to do. And you didn't do it because he gave you an option, because he didn't force his way on it to anybody. You committed yourself to the call, whatever the call was. You committed yourself to that call. He said he'd stand at the door and knock. He don't force his way onto nobody, but we make that commitment. Because like you, Pastor, hit it good. You could take the whole lesson on that because it's no platform for you. It's no pat on the back for you. And so once we look back over it, we say, oh, no, I ain't going to do that. Like, well, that's not going to hurt nobody. Like, it is going to hurt somebody because you have committed yourself and you have told God that you was going to do whatever that task is. And so that should be enough right there for you to start thinking about, like, you know, I mean, I messed up, I did this. But we let all kinds of things hinder us from doing that, but we're committed to the things that's important to in our lives at that time. We're committed to doing whatever it is that we feel that's important to us. Some people are committed to their job. Some people are committed to whatever it is that they feel that's important to them. But there's nothing you can do in this world without God on your side. So if you're going to be committed to God first and let everything else work its way out. Because that's the relationship. You're not going to prosper in anything you do without God being in it. But the problem is we don't want to be held ever accountable because accountability comes with commitment.
I don't think in this day and age in which we live, accountability is something that we rationalize with, even as believers, because we feel as though we have an option. And most people, when you talk to them from the level of Christianity, we have a tendency to act as though we have an option to either do as we will or not do as we will. And there is no conviction when I decide not to do something, even though I'm in a covenant that requires of me to do it, I feel as though I have a personal right not to do things. And that's not true to the word of God, because God holds us accountable as servants of God, as sons and daughters of God. He charges us, Matthew 28, to go out in the world and to make disciples of all men. That's a charge. And that's a commitment. That's a commitment and a command. And when we answer the banner, he didn't say go out into the world as you will. He didn't say go out into the world when you feel like it. Amen. He didn't say go out in the world when you just available. because all of us find ourselves sometimes being used of God and being pushed of God in unpredictable moments and unforeseen moments where we felt that we wanted to do something different and God led us to doing his will over our will. And that's one of the key parts of being a servant of God, is putting his will before your will. He said, I have to be first. I'm a jealous God.
That's right.
Thou shalt put no other God before me. So he holds us accountable. Not only does he hold us based upon our commitment, but he's committed to us also based upon our commitment.
Amen.
Okay.
Amen. So we have to commit ourselves to the Lord. Proverbs 16:3 says, commit to the Lord whatever you do, and he will establish your plans. We have to serve him, commit to him first. A lot of times we let pride take over. We let circumstances and situations take over when all we have to do is go to God with it, and God will work that thing out for you if you have been committed to him. Now, if you have been sitting on a fence and not doing what you're supposed to do, it might not work out like you exactly want it to work out, because we must allow him to be our guidance, because you can never lose by being committed to God. When you're truly committed to God, you will never, there's nothing, you will never lose in whatever you're trying to do. Because we have breakdowns because we're so busy. You have people that have nervous breakdowns. They have nervous breakdowns because they're busy doing their own thing. It wasn't because they were busy committed to what God have told them to do, because God would have gave them some peace. God would have given them the rest that they needed to get it done. And he would have let them do some of the things that they wanted to do as well. But the problem is that we have decided to do our thing first. And then if we have some time, we will take care of what God have required us to do, what we have voluntarily committed ourselves to.
Minister Mays, can I read that same verse from a different translation?
Sure.
Yep. The Message Bible quotes it this way. It said, but God, put God in charge of your works. Then what you have planned will take place. The Living Bible says, commit your works to the Lord, then it will succeed. So you can go through different varieties of verses, versions of the Bible, and you're going to see that whenever we commit to doing God's will, it automatically causes us to be successful in the things that we do. And I love the King James, because he said, commit yourself to God, and then your plans, P-L-A-N, will work together. The reason why a lot of our plans, and we make daily plans about things that we're going to do in our life and things that we're going to accomplish in our life, and they never take place, because we fail to do the most important thing, and that's committing to God first. Thank you, Minister Ambrose, because it's right there in black and white. It says, if you commit to the Lord, whatever you do, your plans will succeed. So the key to me being successful and the key to me succeeding in my plans, whatever they are, he didn't say in your spiritual plans, he said in your plans. So this commitment to God weighs over into every area of your life. Mr. Ambrister, I put on there the New Living Translation, commit your actions to the Lord and your plans will succeed. So your works, your actions, your charge, all that's connected. So why am I not succeeding, Pastor Long, Minister Mays, Minister Armbrister, Minister Sarah? I'm not succeeding because God is not in my plans.
Mm-hmm.
God is not the head of my plans.
Right.
That's right.
Amen. And God don't have it that way, because there's a promise to come along with the commitment. He promised, Lord, I will be with you always, even until the end of age. Okay, Minister Mays. Thank you, Minister Ambrose.
So we have to we have to commit ourselves. We don't belong to ourselves. Is it Romans 12:1? He tells us to, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and Amen. Acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And then reasonable. He tells us in two, reasonable service. Then he tells right. us in two, he says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. It's our reasonable service. He says it's your reasonable service. Why is it hard for us to be committed? We can look right now on our timeline on this Zoom call on this April the 7th of 2021, and we can understand that because it's 80 degrees outside, by the grace of God, he allowed the sun to shine on both sides of the street, that folks have decided that they wasn't going to even be committed to coming onto a Zoom Bible study.
Well, I bless you for that statement, but they're not committed when it's 60 degrees either. One of the things that we suffer with is a lack of commitment in the body of Christ now, because when I was a younger man, and we established certain things and certain obligations to the body of Christ and to God and to the church, we made it our business to make sure those things that were carried out. And that was first priority in our lives. And because we lacked more during that time, the commitment was greater from believers. But because God has blessed us abundantly, our commitment has decreased instead of increasing. What does it profit a man to gain the world and lose his soul?
Right.
And what would a man give in exchange for his soul? So we have to ask ourselves the question, am I substituting my will and the things of my world with the things of God? And that's a personal question that we need to ask ourselves.
Amen. Because we like, I figure out what, Pastor, we like what we like, yeah. You know, and so in Matthew 7 and 13 and 14, Minister Armbrich, if you could pull that up for them to read, Matthew 7 and 13 and 14, he talks about the narrow gate and the wide road. And a lot of us, we enjoy the wide road. We enjoy the road to destruction. We enjoy that because the narrow gate have too many restrictions for us. We don't want to be restricted. We have let pride and everything else. We like the disobedience. We like the sin. We like the being a hellraiser. We like all those things that's no good for us that we shouldn't be doing. We like those things. So we think that we can hide on a wide road. But at the end of the day, you're not hiding from God. Because you have chose to be, you have said you were committed and not committed, God will hold you accountable.
Yes, he does.
You're not getting away with it. God holds you accountable. You make a fool, Pastor. Sometimes you make a fool of me. Sometimes you make a fool of Minister Sarah. Sometimes Minister Armbrister. But you're not getting away with anything because God sees it all. God knows it all. God knows in your heart whether you were really committed from the beginning anyway. Whether it was just mouth service that you was doing or whether you was really committed. Because if you were really committed and didn't fulfill whatever it was, then God will make sure that it all works out. It's not a problem. Because like Pastor said earlier, emergencies do come up. Emergencies happen. But at the end of the day, if my track record continues to show that everything I said I'm going to do for God, that I never do it, then it's going to be looked at according to that way.
Okay, we're concerned with the works of men. And like you're saying, Minister Mays, God's going to judge us in the final judgment according to our works. If you turn to Revelation chapter 20, verse 12, which says, "And I saw the dead, the small and the great, stand before God, and the books were open, and another book was open, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the book." We're going to be judged by our works. Yeah. And our works is the commitment that God has ordained for us to do. Not your occupation, people.
Yes, there you go.
God's not going to judge you for how you worked at your occupation. He's talking about the kingdom of God.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we misinterpret the call of God because we put minute things and worldly things before the things of God. And a lot of us is going to miss out on the kingdom of God, because that works that he's talking about judging us upon is the works that he have called us to do. Praise God.
Yes.
And they're not a work that you can do when you feel like doing. It's a work that he called you to do. And whatever God tasks you to do, as believers, we know what the task is, even if we don't do it. We know what the task is. We make excuses about the task, and we make excuses and reasons why we couldn't do what he has called us to do. And God's writing it down. He don't have an eraser on his pencil.
That's right.
And I have come to realize in my life of salvation and walking with God, our judgment ain't going to come when we get before the judgment seat of God. Some of us are living our judgment daily.
Yep.
The things that we go through, the things we suffer. God said, those I love, I chasten.
Yep. He didn't say when you got. Yep.
So if I got to do certain things to get your attention and to draw you back in, no man findeth me except I bring him to salvation.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
So that's what's important. Understanding that the things we do for God has a great important part on where our rewards from God and our where we're going to spend eternity is. Mm-hmm. I would hate to us to stand before God and hear him say, depart from me, ye ruler of iniquity. I know you not.
Mm-hmm.
And you say, Lord, but I cast out demons, and I healed the sick, and I prayed for these people. And he said, no, you did it in falsehood. You did it because you were trying to get established, or you wanted your name in lights. You didn't do it for my glory.
Right.
Amen. Amen. That's right. He tells us in Romans 14 and 12, and to Sarah, he says, so then each of us will give an account of ourselves to God.
Right.
Romans 14 Amen. And 12, you'll give into account of yourself to God. So if I were you, I would choose to be committed to God, and everything else will work itself out. Do what you said you was going to do. If God have charged you with something, do it to the best of your ability. God is looking for truly committed people. You should be committed because God is committed to us.
Yes, he is.
But are we really, when we look at our lives, are we really committed to God? Do we have the right attitude to be committed? You know, that's one of the things that we suffer with is, how's our attitude? I've never seen so many Christians talk about putting down their religious side for a minute. A committed person can't put down your religious side for a minute.
Amen.
Because if you can put down your religious side or put down what you say you are, if you could put that down and pick it back up, then is it really true?
Amen.
Is it really true? You're gonna make you come out of what?
Right. Right.
So, are we finally? Go ahead, Pastor. Go ahead.
Another good text that indicates that is James chapter 2, verse 9, in the NASB. It reads this way: but if you show partiality, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law as a transgressors. All right? We can't show partiality on doing things when we feel like doing them and when we want to do them. We got to be totally committed. God want a total commitment. And when you look up this word commit and commitment, it has multiple meanings in the Greek and the Hebrew. And it covers a variety of things, but it still covers, in basics, a commitment of responsibility. Mm-hmm. The main usage is dedication and commitment of responsibility. Amen. And we have to practice. We have to practice that as laborers, as ministers, as workers of God.
Amen.
We got to be committed.
Amen. So, and commitment comes with a cost. It you know, being self-denial. We have a cross to bear. But no matter what the cost is, continue to follow Christ.
Right.
Continue to do what he said. He didn't say that every day was going to be easy when you're committed. He didn't say that the sun was shining every day in your life. He didn't promise us that. But the one thing I do know is that if God is with you, you will make it out on the other side, okay?
Amen.
If you're sitting and you're not sure if God is with you, you're going to have an issue along the way. You're going to stop along the way. Sometimes God gives us an assignment and we stop in the middle of our commitment level and lose focus and focus back onto what something that we did on yesterday. Whatever you have done on yesterday has already been done. It's already sealed. It's already done. Focus on what you can do for Christ starting today better. Focus on in our prayer lives that we can draw closer to God. But the problem is that we have allowed things to become our little gods in our lives. And we find ourselves serving and worshiping those little things. And we make sure that those things take precedence in our life. And then we see it in the lives of believers when they are doing those kind of things, because their lives are spiraling out of control. And then they're talking about what's going on in my life. I can't remember. Well, have you checked yourself to see where your commitment to God has been? Have you been truly committed to God? Have you slacked some? Because sometimes you will find yourself slacking.
Amen.
And especially being in the midst of a pandemic, it's easy to find yourself slacking some. It's easy to close up the Bible and put it down. Right. It's easy not to study because, you know, who am I going to talk to? It's easy. But God requires us to continue to go forth. We cannot stop now. In fact, we should be drawing. I think now we should draw closer to God because he has given us time to sit down. Some of us, some folks have even got paid to sit at home. So you don't even have to worry about money. He has even made a way for you. Out of nowhere, you didn't even, it was expected, but God has continued to bless you. You haven't lost not one thing during the pandemic when you were supposed to be losing, lost everything. They're supposed to have lost everything, but God had you covered. And why is it so hard for us to stay committed to him? Even during the pandemic, we should be drawn closer to him because we don't know what's going on, but I know who holds the world in their hand.
Amen. Amen.
It's our God, it's our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. But so are you committed? It's being committed is a personal choice. He don't force his way onto you.
Yes, sir.
But God is looking for total commitment.
Say that again, Reverend. Yes, he is.
God is looking for total commitment. Not partial, not when you feel like it. He's looking for total commitment. When we are going through, when we're sick, we're looking for God to show up for us.
Yes, sir.
You're right, Minister Sarah. I see you. We don't know how blessed we really are.
And amen.
There's folks that have survived better in the pandemic than they did in the everyday before the pandemic. By the grace of God, by God have opened up things for him. God have extended folks unemployment. God have done things that they have never seen happen before. But it's because of his goodness that he have done this for us. And he's asking for committed people now. How can you not want to be committed to God? Look at all the stuff that he has done for us. It started over at Calvary over 2,000 years ago.
Yes, sir.
He committed to us.
Yes, sir.
You guys have any questions? I'm going to give it to Pastor, and then we'll go to questions, and we'll get out of here. It's 55 after. Time flies when you're having fun. Somebody said, well, how are you having fun? I love talking about the word of God. Every opportunity I get, I want to share the word with somebody.
Amen.
You ain't even got to act like you listening to me. I'm going to still say what the Lord have gave me to say. You know, Minister, it is what it is. As long as I think that your ear is open a little bit, I'm going to say it, because if I can just plant a little seed, then somebody else might be able to come through and water it for you. And then somebody else might be able to see it grow. But if I can just start it off sometime, you know, I'm good with that.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Pastor.
I just thank God for this lesson on commitment. It's one of the things that we need to be taught more of when it comes to the Word of God. And I'm not going to say it's sad to say that when we look at the church today in this day and age, we don't resemble the church of the Bible. We don't resemble the people of God that we were formerly trained to resemble and to look like for our forefathers and our mothers. They sacrificed their lives for the kingdom of God, and God played a significant role in each one of their lives. My dad, if he didn't go to church, he didn't go to work on Monday. If he didn't go to Bible class, he didn't go out to the shows and to do leisure things, because he taught us as kids that God was our first commitment. And if we put God first, then those other things we could enjoy, but he never wanted us to make the mistake of not putting God first. And amen. I solidified to the body of Christ that we really need to take a reevaluation and look at our commitment to God. If we want to receive the blessings of God, then it calls us to be more dedicated, especially in this day and age when dedication seems to be unpopular because of the situation that we find ourselves in. Yes, it's easy to find a reason to say why we are not on here on the first and third Wednesday. I remember we had every Wednesday. I remember we had every week prayer service, every Sunday prayer service, and people were dying to get in there, but the need was greater. But like you said, Minister Sarah and Minister Mays, sometimes I question, has God really helped us by blessing us?
Mm-hmm.
Amen. That's right.
Because it seemed like the more we progress and the greater we have, the less we want to serve and thank the giver of the gift.
Right.
Amen.
I'm reminded about the 10 lepers.
Mm-hmm.
All 10 were healed, but only one came back.
Right. Yeah.
To offer thanks.
Mm-hmm.
And I find us being in company of the nine.
Right.
No one wants to come back and say, Lord, I thank you. How do you tell God thank you? It's not just literally saying, Lord, well, I thank the Lord. I thank him every day when I rise in the morning. Well, what are you doing to progress his kingdom in the earth?
Our service.
That's what God holds us accountable for. What are we doing to progress the kingdom of God in the eyes of sinners who don't know him as Lord and Savior? How much valuable time do we spend witnessing for the kingdom of God?
Mm-hmm.
And is your witness only valuable when there's a crowd around? When there's a microphone in front of your hand, when there's an audience to be heard.
Yes.
So I think we need to take a good strong look at our commitment to God. And if we find falter in our commitment to God, God is so loving and he's so just, he's not going to hold it against us. He said, dust yourself off, get off your lazy behind, and get into the work that I have called you to do. No one can fill your position in the kingdom of God. God has designated each one of us for a special gift and a special part in the body of Christ. And each one of us must fulfill our purpose.
Yep. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Somebody said to me the other day, if you don't use it, you lose it.
Yes.
Hallelujah. But it doesn't, let me help somebody tonight. It doesn't mean because you lose it, God's giving what he gave you to do to somebody else. He let them step in with the gift he gave them. What you've done never gets accomplished.
Right.
No one can fill your spot. Stop thinking that. Stop saying it.
Right.
Somebody said, well, how can you say that, Pastor Long? Because you got to die for you. And he's going to hold you accountable. I can't go on your behalf as much as I would like to. Christ was the only answer that we had. and he died for your sins. But even on the, even within the death of the cross, we have a commitment to accept God, Jesus, as Lord and Savior. Him dying on the cross is not going to benefit you except you accept him.
Amen.
That's right.
Hello, somebody.
That's it. That's the word.
You are dying, go to hell, saying Jesus died on the cross if you don't accept him. That's hello. Right. That's right. And accept him. He said, he told Nicodemus, Nicodemus, you must be born again. So we thank you, Minister Mays, for this lesson tonight. And I challenge every listener, every hearer that sees this video to really look at your life and evaluate how you committed to God. Somebody said, well, how do I do that, Pastor? Well, I'll give you a very simple solution. Mm-hmm. For those of you that have occupations, do you spend more time with God or do you spend more time in your occupation? Hallelujah. We say we tithers, but does a tithe just mean what you earn? God wants some of our time as well.
Amen.
So you answer the question. And if there's fault there, then you have an area to work upon. Amen. Because God has given all of us time to get ourselves together. Amen. And my brothers and sisters, I challenge you tonight. If you want to enjoy the kingdom of God, if you want to reign with Christ in eternity forever, then you got to do something down here. Because Revelation's already told us every man will be judged according to his work shall be.
That's right.
No work. Amen. No work, no pay.
Yes.
I told my grandson, he just started working. I asked him a question. I said, son, if you don't go to work all week, what happens at the end of the week? And then I even made it simpler for him. I said, go to work every day and don't do your job. Sit at the table and don't do what's required of you. And I said, at the end of the week, see how quick you will get a paycheck. So you can be in a place and still not qualify for a benefit. I'm closing with that. Closing with that. Hallelujah.
Amen. Any more questions? Any more comments? Any more concerns?
Amen. I just wanted to say one thing. You don't lose when you're committed to God. A lot of people think that when you say you're going to do what God asks you to do and you're living for God, that you're going to miss out on something. You never miss out on anything, because if you're truly committed to God, then your way of thinking has already changed. You have to have a renewing of the mind. When I got saved, I didn't still say, I'm going to go, I still go out here and drink like I used to drink and do all that other stuff. My mind frame, my mindset was different because I wanted to do better. I wanted to live for God. I wanted to make sure that I go to heaven and encourage other people to do that. You have to have a mind, a different mindset when you're being committed to God. You can't have the same, you can't think the same. It's like when you get through elementary school, you go to junior high school, you don't think the same because you're not the same person. When you give your life to Christ and you say you're committed to him, you're not the same person anymore. You're a different person. You're a new creation in him. And we have to remember that. And got the scripture that you said, commit all thy ways to him and he'll your plans. God still lets us get our plans, like you said, my shepherd, but our plans are not what we thought about before we got saved. My plan back then was, yeah, let me go on and make this money and flip this right quick and that. That's not my plans anymore.
Amen.
But a lot of us still come to
God said it this way, Minister Sarah, and I know we over time. He said, my thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are not your ways. And it's only one mind that a man of God can put on or a woman of God can put on. He said, let this mind be in you, which were also in Christ Jesus. We only have one mind that we can operate in.
That's
the mind of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody said, well, what is the mind of Christ? The word of God.
Word of God.
Everything we need is written in the volume of the book of God, the holy book of God.
Mm-hmm.
That's our book of instructions. Go ahead, Mr. Sir. I didn't mean to cut you off. I had my turn.
I'll share. But I enjoyed the lesson. And like I said, you don't lose with God. We just have to have a different mindset. And being committed is not a drag. It's the best thing I ever did was giving my life over to Christ. And I'm reaping the benefits now. Trust me, I'm reaping the benefits of being committed to Christ. That's all I'm saying.
there are benefits. There are benefits right now that you can reap.
Amen.
Anybody else, Minister Ambrosio, you have anything before we close up?
Just that I appreciate this lesson that you shared with us, and I ask God to continue to bless you with the wisdom and knowledge to be able to continue to share with us in the future.
Amen. Thank you.
Anybody else? We'll end in prayer. Father God, we first of all thank you for this lesson. Thank you for this opportunity. Lord, touch us right now, Lord. Show us, guide us in how to be more committed, Lord, that we can open our minds and hearts up and allow you in to show us that way right now, Lord. Lord, we ask you to continue to bless our pastor and co-pastor. Lord, continue to strengthen them. Lord, continue to encourage them right now, Lord. We ask that you will touch the sick all over right now, Lord. We ask that you will protect and cover us right now, Lord. We ask that you will touch our governor right now, Lord. Touch her mind right now, Lord, that she may be able to make the right decisions that she needs to make to get us back to where we need to be, Lord. We thank you right now because we know that you will take over right now, Lord, and you will get us back to where we need. But we're going to continue to lean and trust and depend on you right now, Lord.
Yes, sir.
Lord, we thank you right now for this day, for this opportunity, for those that's on this line right now. Lord, we thank you for them right now, Lord, those that could not make it for whatever reason. Lord, we ask that you will be merciful and touch them right now.
Yes,
Lord, we ask that you will continue to look down on the Reader family, Lord, and they have some struggling days ahead right now, Lord, but I know you are a comforter that have never left us right now, Lord, and you will get them through right now, Lord, and touch us right now that we may have the word to tell them when they call and reach out to us right now, Lord. We thank you right now for Jesus, Lord. We thank you for the cross right now, Lord, that is because the cross that I'm here today, Lord. We ask that you will touch the hungry that's on the street corners, Lord, that you will touch them right now, Lord, that you will give them some spiritual food, not just regular food right now, Lord. We thank you right now for your thank son, you. Jesus, right now, Lord. We ask all these things in Jesus' name.
Amen.
God bless you, Minister Mays.
Bless you.
God bless you all. Have a beautiful night.
Thank you. Love y'all.